Geology, geology, geology. Welcome to everybody to the Mini Geology Show. This is Daniel Mesini, your inquisitive geologist. Today, we're going to talk about the history of petroleum. The world has relied on the hydrocarbons since the 900s. A tool that greatly helped the finding of oil was the wireline log. And today we'll focus on the period, the technology, and the mindset of the protagonists around this crucial invention, able to detect the petroleum reservoirs. The wireline log idea grew in a fertile environment among geologists, mining engineers, physicists, and electrical engineers. And we will follow the process that allowed the development of this idea. And we will be led by the historian of petroleum and gas, Francesco Gerali, who is calling in from Italy. Welcome, Francesco.
Thanks, thanks a lot. How are you doing, Daniel? How are you doing?
We're doing very fine here, and I'm glad that you could connect on the other side of the pond. To tell us a little bit about this very specific tool, and we're interested in understanding how the idea developed, how the people that invented this tool came up with the idea, how they applied it, and how it was commercialized. So, Francesco, please try to set the stage for us.
Okay, Daniel. Well, wireline logs is a very well-known term, and we would like to dig into the story of this technology. And I would like to point my focus today with you around the 1910s, 1930s. We are going to talk about the so-called in French carottage électrique, that is the electrical logs. The history of the wireline logs had its inception in Alsace, in France. The real tool, the technology, as the first development, commercial development in France. But we have to dig inside other sites to find the early core, early idea of how to use electricity to rid the subsoil in the search for mineral ores and then oil and gas.
Who were the people that they invented this tool?
Okay. The early idea to use electricity to find mineral ores was taken in United Kingdom. The United Kingdom, there were two geologists slash engineers that decided to start to work on the properties of electrical transmission in the subsoil and try to detect to understand if it was possible to find minerals.
In this period, 1910s, 1930s, almost let's say 100 years ago, we
Yes.
know that the British, they knew related to geology, they knew more than anybody else about the occurrence of the petroleum systems. On the other side, the Germans, they were more sophisticated in the analysis of organic geochemistry and the technology. And the French, they were more into the drilling technology. Can you explain
Exactly.
you why so?
Because they have French have a great tradition in hydraulic engineers, a great tradition in developing drillers and tools for drilling for the search of waters. So we have to remember that among the five, six most representative treatises on drilling, on the heart of used probe, at least three are from France. So in France, drilling was a very advanced technology, correct?
And so we are in these years at the beginning of the 1900s, and we have a convergence of two important elements. On one side, we have the investors that they are aware of an emerging market, because this is the moment where you have the industry of cars, power plants, the engines of the new ships, the airplanes. And then on the other side, we have this important element, which is the growing knowledge about the hydrocarbons. Can you tell us more about the context where we merge these two important elements?
The contest is a very well-known contest in business history in terms of energy supplies. Is the contest of the post-World War I, where humankind globally acknowledged the need for petroleum and gas. At some point, World War I was a watershed in the energy sector, because the heavy mechanization, the role that had the engine, the four-stroke engine, diesel engine, in moving the war machine was clear, was something that there was no doubt about the importance of petroleum and gas. So at some point, petroleum and gas turned to be more than a big oil company issue, matter, subject of business, but more a state, a government-owned topic. Not a coincidence that already in 1916, 1917, pretty much all the European governments started to implement national state-owned policies. Oil was declared by, to conclude, was declared by the governments all over the world, was declared a priority. 1917, 1919 are the years of petroleum started to be intended as an energy must.
Well, if the governments and the states, they are so interested into this new resource, how did they plan the new knowledge around this topic?
The National Geological Surveys first, together with the National Mining Centers, state geologists, state engineers, a partnership with the private industry for sure was the backbone of the petroleum industry. They started first to tie stronger relations, because they were the current producers, the providers for the oil supply. So everything was made more a stronger relation with the industry. But as well, the states decided that we need to develop a public, general public knowledge for the petroleum wealth, gas wealth, energy abundance of the specific country called in the search of oil. And another action that they taken, they started to acquire, to buy leases, pieces of land that were known as petroleum lands, petroleum deposits. On this land, started to develop petroleum activities and then to create storage. So at some point, national government started to be oil, petroleum and gas entrepreneurs. So the concept of state oil.
And we are in the 1910s, 1920s, but at this point, in these early decades of the 1900s, still 90% of the wells, they were dry. And the geologists, they were using this idea of creekology. Do you want to talk about the creekology?
The creekology was a kind of a fake science. I mean, there was the idea that if you dig your well close to creek rivers beds, you have the possibility to find more oil than in other parts. Because started to be applied this idea since the very early 1859, 1860, 61, the early days of the Pennsylvania petroleum industry, because the majority of the petroleum fields were found along creeks. But there was a kind of matter of coincidence. And also we have to remember that the early Pennsylvania oil business started because Pennsylvania was really floating over a cap of petroleum and gas. Was a huge bonanza, was a very lucky area. They found oil when they were digging for something else, when they were digging for water, when they were digging for salt, especially. They started to find oil, and it was very annoying. They didn't want oil. But at some point, they realized that that was a land for oil and started to also to associate to creekology the science of the rudiments. Oil is found in water wells. Oil is found close to rivers. So if you find water, for sure you will find oil. So this was the early association of ideas in the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, the 19th century, in the moment where people tried to develop universal theory of finding oil. We need to find the philosophical stone of oil. That was the big chimera of the early oil finders, looking for the philosophical system to find petroleum. So creekology was one of those.
The entrepreneurs, though we understand now in the early 20th century, they were not happy because of this situation. And they looked for a professional figure to reduce the risk. They need more certainty, as you said. And so they acknowledged at some point that professional figure was the geologist. But however, the geologist, as you well explained, was also in need for new methods to explore and map this petroleum reservoir. So this is the moment, first decades of the 20th century, when the geologist meets the engineers, the geophysicists, and other professional figures of other disciplines. Can you tell us more about this moment when different professional figures, they meet and they create that fertile environment where new discoveries and new inventions will happen?
Sure. The geologist was already in touch with the drilling engineer, but we are doing two very different jobs. Or sometimes was the mining engineer that was taking on his shoulders the work of the petroleum geologist, and as well then was working in oil producing, oil drilling. So we have this kind of developing pulp trying to taking a shape. I mean, the union between geologists, drilling engineers, and the physicist in between the 1910s, 1920s. The early example came from Hungary, and we are talking about the physicists of the heart. I mean, people that were basically pure physicists, that decided to start how we can study the planet below the crust using physical principles. And the first idea was the torsion balance from Hungary.
Why were they interested in the physicists? Why they look at the Earth? Why were they interested in studying this new subject?
Basically, to start understand the dynamic of the Earth movements, largest portion of the curiosity came after the study of seismic. And seismic is another important word to keep in mind for the early development of geophysical technology to find oil. Because at some point in 1920s, we have seismic methods, magnetic methods, and gravimetry methods. So three geophysical technologies to find to detect oil.
Who was that group of people that they decide to apply these three geophysical tools or methodologies into the oil and gas industry?
The idea started gradually, first for the search of regular mine ores, like copper, like to detect iron, other minerals. Then the word spread around also the petroleum environment, and they started to apply, to develop these systems also to detect for petroleum. And for in the case of the torsion balance, the real strong introduction of the torsion balance for finding petroleum, we have that in the United States, and then also in Mexico, but first in the United States, because of Everett Lee de Goliar. We know Everett Lee de Goliar as the most important Hawkes geologist that had an important role in the early petroleum finding in Mexico in 1910s, and then had an important role in the development of geophysics applied to petroleum. And not a coincidence that in terms of physical studies, electronics, and many other things, the company founded by de Goliar along the years moved to many other sectors and then merged, basically was at the base of the foundation of Texas Instruments. At the very early roots of the company Texas Instruments, there was the geophysical research company opened by Everett Lee de Goliar. There was one of the greatest in the 30s, 40s, and early 50s petroleum geologist consultant, and that had an important, a very important, probably unique role in the development of the utilization of torsion balance and then seismic technologies for petroleum. So you can find petroleum in many, many, many places. Even you use your calculator, Texas Instruments, there's no petroleum inside, but at the very, very early base, there is a tie with the petroleum industry. Yes.
Let's move, Francesco, to the core of our program today, which is the object itself that we are gonna talk about, and then the idea on how that was invented. The term, the official term, is carotage electric, a set of tools and methods based on the electric resistivity used for the very first time in 1927. It was used to detect the differences in the porosity of specific oil sands deposited in the Oligocene in an area in the Alsace region, the eastern part of France, what is France today. Who invented this carottage electric?
It was not originally developed for petroleum and gas, not at all. And this is something that shares with the other technologies, seismic, gravitational, and gravimetry. At the very beginning, the idea started around 1911 in Paris, where Konrad Schlumberger was professor of physics. He wanted to study if it was possible by the transmission of the electrical impulses in the subsoil, if it was possible to detect an answer, and depending by the answer, this electric answer, understand what you can find below the soil. He was a pure physicist. He was also trained in mining, and he had a research and teaching position. He was a very well-known, acknowledged scholar. It was also very motivated in this kind of mining studies because he came from an important family that had many interests in mining, but overall in petroleum. I tell you why. We have to remember that the region of Petrelbronn, the Alsatia, was the petroleum reservoir of France, the petroleum reservoir of Western Europe since the 18th century. This is a long, long story, a long tradition of petroleum finding, refining, and commercialization in Alsatia. And the family Schlumberger, of German origin, they were a very notable family involved in banking, state administration, and they had also a role, a script into the local petroleum business. But for some reasons, the two brothers, the Schlumberger brothers, decided to work outside this family business. At some point, they started to develop something amatorial way in their lands, try to research, to develop the system with their own money and their means before the war. The war arrived, was a disaster. They were both called to serve, and especially Marcel Schlumberger served as an artillery officer and started and wanted to propose to the government, to the War Department, the idea that using electric technology to detect the soil, it was possible to identify the booming of the German cannons. But that happened very late in the 1970s, and basically very little result was obtained by Schlumberger.
Let me ask you one thing before you move on with the story, just to be clear. We're talking about the Schlumberger family, what is
correct.
Now also a Schlumberger company. So we are talking about these two brothers, Konrad and Marcel Schlumberger. You describe them as skilled,
skilled
people that they study. The brothers, Konrad and Marcel Schlumberger, they were part of a rich family, and they
yes.
were financed also by their parents.
The father that has an important role, the father was had many manager roles in the local Alsatian consortium of the petroleum industry of the area. So he was a man of petroleum, but as well a man of power that was in the main environments, in the main rooms where oil was controlled, administrated, commercialized.
So we are creating now, it's emerging a context where two very skilled brothers with a rich family in a position of power,
yes,
that they live in an area where you have resources in Alsatia, they mm-hmm. come up with this invention. So walk us through what are the technical steps in order to reach this invention.
Okay. The technical steps, first we have to say that was a family affair, a family business. Because after the war, we have to remember that both the two brothers served and got pretty shocked about how can be bad the war. And they were pretty confused. They were not sure about what kind of career take, because they were, yes, science-based, but they were also lovers of arts and humanities. And they were very skilled in writing. So they were close to start a career in sociology, poetry, literature, and writing. The family Schlumberg, especially the father, said, guys, you can take this step if you want, but you have skills. You studied a lot. You are very good in what you do. I would like to invest in your skills. And the father invested something that in the $2,000, if I remember well, can be estimated in $500,000, invested like $500,000 in the company of the brothers. And they had to sign a contract with the father. We are going to develop that. We are going to use this money only to that. And we are going to work together.
To do what?
To the development of an electrical system technology, electrical tool to detect ores in the subsoil. So the business was to try to detect metals in the subsoil. And they started to work. And they achieved very good results. They were actually living in Paris. They were a Paris family, but they soon also moved back in Alsatia. And they had great success. They also started to work in Romania, Poland, Germany with good results. And it was in Romania that at some point they realized that it was possible to find oil and gas, but was not the at the beginning the core business. But we have to understand something. We have to understand the difference between two words, surface and subsurface technology. The early electrical system for detect ores and oil, the seismic technology, the gravimetry technology, and we say the magnetic technology were surface technologies. To simplify the technological terminology, they put some probes, some tools, right at the very surface of the land. They did their job. And they detected from the surface. The turning point of the date you mentioned, the 1927, and now we are arriving there, we are close, we are 1925, but I want to anticipate. The turning point was to go the subsoil to get the log. At the very beginning, the utilization of electricity for petroleum finding started pretty much in several stages between 1923 and 1925 was from the surface. This technology got attracted the interest of the Roxana Oil Company, that was a branch of the early Royal Dutch Shell, and was the company that was developing lands in Venezuela. So in 1925, they got an important contract. They had the real big strike. They had the possibility to work for the Royal Dutch Shell. They were quite successful, but Shell was not doing very well in that area. They decided to change the targets. So that contract that was supposed to be a long contract, at some point around the end of 1926, early 1927, was basically broken. That was a huge strike for the brothers Schlumberger. There was the moment in which they say, well, we are in a turning point. I'm studying on that since 1912, 1911. Our father after the war gave us plenty of money. We are the heirs of an important family of business tradition. We can't fail. So now we have to consider two important facts. First, the proud of the two guys. That they say, we can't fail. We need to find out. We need to understand how we can improve this technology, how we can provide the piece of paper, the log, to the oil company and say, look, here is the photograph of the subsoil you look for. So first they wanted to do that. First factor. Second factor, Alsatia, petroleum. Heavy petroleum interest of the family, we have to remember something, that the society was among between the two brothers. But Conrad was the scientific mind. Conrad probably was the genius. Conrad was the scientist. Marcel was very good in managing. Marcel was a wonderful manager. Marcel was the prototype of the very good petroleum business coming from the petroleum family. And at some point, the brother and other people in that circle, 1924, more or less, they purchased the oil leases. But at some point, they were ready to give back to the state the license because they were not finding oil. They had some troubles. That happens in the moment that the electric society, or the Marcel and the Conrad, were in trouble after the loss of Shell. So they have a problem with the electricity, let's say that, and they have a problem with petroleum. It was a kind of tough year for the Schlumberger brothers, 1927. What they did? They tried to develop a system that they had already in mind since a few months, but they never realized it because it was technically awkward. I explain you what I mean. They realized, obviously, already in Romania, the possibility to find oil with, we say, surface technology, surface log, but they developed the idea that if it was possible to put the probes in the subsoil, in the drilling hole, probably we can get some more results. It seems that they already tried something with the people of Shell in Alsatia, when they invited them, people of Shell from Paris, to visit what they were doing in the family possessions. They gave up. they still remain, they still propose to sell their surface wire log system. 1927, at the very late August, not Marcel, not Conrad were in Petzelbron, in Alsatia, but Henry Doll, a young engineer that was then in 1927 married with the daughter of Conrad, was an important man in the structure of the company as a very skilled scientist, young, quick, and very, very gifted in the lab as in the field, was him that invented pretty much from the scratch the way to put all the needed probes, cable, and whatever from horizontal to vertical down for about 90 meters, let's say 85-86 yards. It was a difficult process that lasted apparently 5 days because they have not enough electric cable. They have not enough long copper cable because they were used to spread some cables in an area and was a cable that was intended to lay on the surface. So when you try to enlarge this, this long cable and put on vertical, the problem it was not very strong. It was not strong enough to keep all the weight to the bottom. And they had a lot of losses, a lot of broken stuff. Was very difficult. But finally, in the early autumn, obtained the first vertical log. It was extremely precise because we know, they discovered that when you find a black spot, when you see that you have a blank in between the line of the log, it means that there's no conductivity. The dark spot is the blank that some point you have when you read your log, because the electrical current, the electricity, stops, can't go more. So that means probably there is a chunk of petroleum there, the dark spot. So they achieved that in 1927. It was immediately a success. We already discovered something that would have changed immediately the world. No. What happened? The system, obviously, they needed money, and they needed a lot of money because to apply that new system, the significance of that was we need to invest in more tools, in more cables, in new machinery. We have to create almost from the scratch all the artifacts we need to go from horizontal to vertical. They need the money. And they started to sell their service in Alsatia, where the family was well known and respected, successful. Was a family with a name. And the two French brothers, Marcel and Conrad, well, almost globally in the Western world, Europe and United States, were renewed. Were two guys that were doing well. Also, he was a decorated officer from the Great War. It was trusted people. So in the moment that they say, fellows, look what we can do here in these wells, they started to be hired. They offered their service. We can see an increase in the production in 1928, then a sort of stabilization Later was a development of the business, and the trend was very positive. But at the very beginning, we had not an explosion. So it didn't make the difference. But the early success of the technology at the local level guaranteed to Marcel and Corrad the necessary income to prepare to build a new technology, and most important, the necessary portfolio. It's like a portfolio, allow me to stretch an expression, the portfolio of an artist. Your portfolio, what you produce. You have all your stuff in an exhibit and you say, this is me, I'm the artist, this is what I can do. And in the petroleum industry, it was very important to have a portfolio. You have to show your success. If you show that where have you been working, offering your service, people found barrels, bulks of barrels, you have a portfolio. You have an history of production. Your services were useful and worked well. So the initial success in the French wells, in that moment, they were not doing very well. So in the moment that we find a kind of not important, but a very welcome rise. They have a kind of a growing and then a stabilization of the growing. That was more than enough for the French market. They say, okay, this system works. We have to remember that Marcel was a skilled business guy. Doll was a very polyhedric, gifted oil professional in the field and in the lab, but also with a pen. And we have to remember that Conrad was a professor of physics, then was a professor of mining technology, was from academia, and he already published in academia many papers. And they said, now that we have a new technology, now that is something that can be defined as a scientific breakthrough, because all, as I said earlier, all the previous technology were surface technology. This is the first time that we dig the hole and we put the probe down the hole. So they started to write scientific papers to present in conferences, conferences for geologists and conference for engineers, drilling engineers. They published in French, they published in English, they published in German. So at some point in 1930-31, after, let's say, 4 or 5 years, they finally established something of importance. They had an important meaning for the international community in terms of oil finding, because this idea of let's put down and down more we can our highs in the subsoil, they launched this idea. We have to go to follow the chisel during the drilling and have continuous log to have a view of where we are going. This is another idea that I started. But let me conclude. They were also an important, they had an important meaning for the petroleum system, the petroleum sector of France. Because the Schellenberger family, with the two brothers, they were already drillers, producers, and refiners, and also commercialized. Officially, with the technology of the of Corrad and Marcel, they started to be also explorers. So the family Schlumberger in Alsatia, basically already in the late 1920s, was the first petroleum family that was running an integrated business together under the same roof, upstream, midstream, and downstream. And this is very important. Probably the first European company, the first oil family, petroleum family, working in this way.
Thank you very much, Francesco. It has been fascinating to listen to this story, and I hope to catch up another time. You are a friend of Mini Geology.
And this Thank you was, very much.
This was another episode of Mini Geology, today with Francesco Gerali, talking about the Schlumberger brothers in the wildline logs. Thank you so much, Francesco.
My pleasure. Thank you very much. Have a good one, Daniel. See you soon. Bye.